God. What happened last night? Wait, where am I? The hell? What is all this crap? VHS tape? Floppy disk?
Actual floppy disk?
This can't be true. That's impossible. I'm nearing obsolescence. Has it really been that long? Okay, think, Eric. Think how to get out of here. How to stop from becoming outdated. What has stood the test of time? Fraggle Rock. No. Yes, Star Wars. With Episode 7 bringing Star Wars back to its roots and Rogue One on its way, this has got to work. Just have to think.
Oh, think Star Wars, think Star Wars. Lightsabers, Vader, music. Oh, Duel of the Fates, that was a great piece. Dogfights, the trench runs, X-Wings and TIE Fighters and pod racing.
Aerobic!
Well, I suppose I owe it to Star Wars for bringing me back, and there's nothing quite so controversial in the Star Wars universe as the prequels. For all the cringeworthy dialogue and eye-rolling moments, they had their moments to shine, and no matter what you say, pod racing was awesome.
Star Wars Episode 1 Racer was released on the Nintendo 64 the same day the film hit theaters, May 19th, 1999. It came to PCs a month later, with Game Boy Color and Macintosh receiving ports in December that same year. What came next was an arcade game from Sega in early 2000, retitled as Star Wars Racer Arcade, with talk of a port to the Dreamcast. Well, the Dreamcast did get a port, just not at the arcade game like everyone expected. It was back to the original. The Sega Dreamcast received the final port of Episode 1 Racer in April of 2000.
We'll be taking a look at the N64 and Dreamcast games today. So fire up your energy couplers, because it's Boonta Eve, and this pod race is just getting started.
Episode 1 Racer on all platforms, with the exception of the Game Boy Color, is a 3D sci-fi racing game all set within the now non-canon Star Wars universe, and it's all pods all the time. It was a smart move to turn arguably the most exciting sequence of the whole film into a game, and it's not difficult to believe that pod racing would be a popular and exciting sport across the galaxy. Anakin might have been the only human that could race pods in the Star Wars universe, but put a controller into your own human hands and now you can too.
Well, sort of.
As the gameplay goes, it's pretty straightforward racing game fare. Race, win, upgrade, unlock new pods and racers, repeat. You'll revisit tracks a few times, but each time you do, you're on new paths and dealing with new obstacles. It's by no means a perfect game, but it is a great way to spend an afternoon, and it's a very strong contender for the best game to spin off of The Phantom Menace.
Alright, that's enough about the games themselves. What makes them different? Not much.
Starting in with the graphics, the Dreamcast has got the edge here, but only just. The graphics of the era, of course, and the N64 provides higher resolution on the textures, provided you have the 4 megabit RAM expansion. There's even an option to drop it down to low res if you really want to.
Everything on the N64 looks decent, and the Dreamcast looks decent-er. But if you want everything to look its decenter-ist, and you don't mind your Dreamcast looking like some new Star Wars creature, it supports VGA out as well.
There's not really much of a jump in quality here, and the Dreamcast could definitely do better. What it did do very nicely was reintroduce the pre-rendered intro sequences from the PC version that played before each race begins. It's not much, but it's nice that they're there if you want them, and thankfully, they're easily skippable, because in my opinion, they're kind of unnecessary. The N64 just shows some aerial shots of the courses as a quick intro, and even those are skippable.
I get that they're trying to set the atmosphere for this big pod racing syndicate or galactic pod racing organization, but think back to those racing games that you love. How much course intro is there really? Next to none, right? In this case, less is more. However, when it comes to the music, less is definitely not more, and Episode 1 Racer delivers pretty well with only a few missteps.
The soundtrack is very Star Wars, having been composed by John Williams himself. The Dreamcast, though, seems to have included more recognizable pieces, like the Force theme and Duel of the Fates. It sounds great, and it fits in perfectly, so at the very least, you get to hear some Star Wars-y tunes while you're racing. On the Dreamcast version, at least, the N64 track music only decides to kick in on the final lap.
It's a new lap record!
I don't know. I guess I could see some people enjoying the more environmental sounds of the track and the pod and whatever, but track music is typically fantastic, and it's a bummer that there's not more of it here. Tunes from like Mario Kart and F-Zero are burned into my brain from years of hearing them over and over.
Mute City. That's all I need to say. I might as well call this episode done right now, because you guys aren't even paying attention anymore, because you just got that Mute City song stuck in your head. But I can't blame you.
That being said, none of the music tracks on the Dreamcast are so particularly outstanding that you'll have them sticking with you after you switch the game off. Regardless, it was an odd choice to leave the first two laps as just the ambient racing sounds, but I will say, at the very least, it gives the final lap a touch of dramatic flair. Once you actually start racing, you get a sense of the speed really nicely. Everything zips past you, but it doesn't ever become overwhelming, and this, perhaps more than anything else, is where the Dreamcast shines. By all reports, it only runs at the standard 30 frames per second, but it looks super smooth, and I wouldn't be surprised at all if it's doing better than that. Whether it is, or just seems like it, that's a huge leg up on the N64. In both, you'll find that your pod controls and responds very nicely. And I'll tell you right now that between the two versions, there is no discernible difference in the control.
Except, of course, for the controller itself. So if you've got a loose analog stick on your 64 controller, and don't worry, everybody faces a loose joystick at some point in their life. You might find the Dreamcast is a tad more responsive, but with a tight stick, they are neck and neck.
What makes the N64 game unique is that it offers a code to use an alternate control scheme, where you play the game with not one, but two controllers. It would have been nice to have been a standard option, but a code is better than not at all. To access the dual controller scheme, plug your second controller into port 3, switch on, and start a new file. Now on the name entry screen, hold the Z button, and using the L button, enter the letters RRDUAL. Then click End. From here, you can continue on to name your file however you like, and you are ready to race. What this does is remaps your throttle for each engine to each of the analog sticks on either controller. This same scheme would also get used for the arcade game to great effect. Pushing both sticks forward gives you full throttle, and to turn, you've got to pull back on one of the two sticks. It's tough to get the hang of, and makes clicking any other button kind of a pain in the ass, but it's a cool novelty to play around with regardless, especially if you find the standard game too easy. What I don't understand is this could have easily been adapted to the L and R triggers on the Dreamcast controller, and it probably would have been more successful, but no chance, Cube. The basics are perfectly fine, accelerator, brake, steering, that sort of thing. But as soon as you want to use anything less essential, like map or camera controls, it starts getting dicey. On the Dreamcast, both the map and camera controls are on the D-pad, meaning you've got to abandon the analog stick and control of your pod altogether in order to reach them. On the N64, the camera controls are mapped to the C button, so they're a bit easier to get to, but still awkward. And God forbid you want to change the map view. That's all the way over on the L button. Yeah.
Well, that's it. I told you not much was different, but where do we stand? Well, I can tell you that my first reaction was the N64 game. And if you want to judge based solely off of content, yeah, it's got the dual control scheme, so there is some exclusive content here that you won't be getting in the Dreamcast. But in my time with both of them, this is the one I'd want to go back into, with smoother visuals, more polished graphics, and more Star Wars music for your buck. The Dreamcast version is undoubtedly the way to go. Both of these, though, are games that deserve more attention, and you guys can rest easy tonight knowing that no matter what your opinion of Episode 1, the film, at least some good came out of it. See you next time. Oh, and may the Force be with you.
Hey everyone, thanks so much for watching, and really thanks for waiting it out with me. Now that I'm out of my nebulous floating nothingness of obscurity, I'm back in the game, ready to get more and more content out to you guys with more comparison videos like this, and a few surprises planned out along the way. I've also got some plans in the works for other series, which I think will be a lot of fun, and I really hope you guys do too. So thanks to you guys for watching, and also just want to throw out a special thanks to everyone out there that really made an effort to stay in touch and encouraged me to dust off my camera and get the show rolling again. So thank you. See you guys on the next GVG.